Well, I'd like to welcome you to the November 17th, 2015 meeting of the Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission. My name is Ryan O'Donnell. I'm the chair of the commission, also the city councilor for Ward 3. I note that there is a quorum present, so I'll call the meeting to order. I'll also note that this meeting is being audio and video recorded. And let's start, as we always do, for the benefit of the public, and also in case we forgot who we are, by doing introductions, starting with our vice chair.
Hi, I'm Lisa Klein. I'm the city councilor for Ward 7.
Dave Pomerantz, director of central services.
Nancy Forrestall, assistant city collector.
Gary Hartwell, citizen.
Dan Brooks, planning board.
Wayne Feigen, planning sustainability. Ned Huntley, public works.
Matt Chan, public works.
Jody Casper, police chief.
Great. And we have our exceptional assistant, Terry Usko, here taking notes as well. So we'll begin, at the beginning of each meeting, we have a period of public comment. I think many people are here today for items that are on the agenda farther down. Is there anyone who is just here to speak on a subject that's not on the agenda or would like to provide public comment in general? No? Okay. Well, seeing none, we'll move into our agenda. The first item is the approval of minutes from September 15th, 2015. Is there a motion to approve those minutes?
Move approval.
Okay, Mr. Hartwell moves approval. Councilor Klein seconds. Any discussion or amendments on the September 15th minutes? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Also the minutes of October 20th, 2015. These are in amended form, the version that was sent out to the commission. It was, the amendments were shown and now they're accepted in this document. And it also has one other change because Rich Cooper at the October 20th meeting was actually not a member of the commission, so didn't participate, but we list him appropriately now in this new version. So those are the October 20th minutes. Is there a motion to approve these minutes?
Move approval.
Okay, is there a second? Okay, Mr. Hartwell makes the motion. Mr. Pomerantz seconds. Any discussion? Amendments or further changes? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Today we have an ambitious agenda and we have many visitors here. So I would like to move up the items in order to respect the time of our visitors. And within that, I would like to move up the items that I suspect will take the least amount of time. So I will do my best to do that, but I think we should actually start with item number 10, which is an ordinance to amend section 312.104 of the code, schedule 3, limited time parking. This is for the purpose of designating a 15-minute parking space on the northeasterly side of King Street, beginning at a point approximately 237 feet southerly of Trumbull Road. Does anyone want to make a motion to get this on the floor? Motion for possible.
So moved.
Ms. Harwell makes the motion. Is there a second? Ms. Brooks seconds. Okay. Would anyone like to speak to this, to introduce it? Perhaps sure. David Brown.
This is a request from several businesses on that section of King Street where the former Bank of America building was. Currently, it's been renovated and turned into Goggins Real Estate. Under the old Bank of America setup, there was a horseshoe driveway providing access and egress onto and off of King Street. When Goggins renovated the property, one side of the driveway was closed off with landscaping, so it's a driveway now that goes to the back of the building only. There is no horseshoe. And the businesses in the vicinity there are looking for a 15-minute parking spot. There is ample space to put in a parking space, and their request is to do a 15-minute space. Since there's a lot of traffic that comes into that area where people are picking up or dropping off documents. I went out and met with Pat Goggins from Goggins Real Estate. I looked at the space. Clearly enough room for a parking space before you get to the first driveway where the Whalen building is, the green building. Certainly, in my mind, it would make good sense to at least put a parking space there, and because of the traffic there, 15-minute space does make sense. So that's the request before the commission.
Okay. And we have a related ordinance, obviously, that may not actually be in the packets, but we're trying to pull it up, and was emailed to the commission. So Mr. Goggins is here. Do you want to speak to this in any way?
David summed it up well.
Okay, sounds good. Any other comments or discussion on the ordinance? I'd like to be able to actually read out the ordinance so we know what we're voting on. Although we can just make a recommendation on the concept, and the ordinance committee can make sure it's in the proper form before it goes to the city council. But any other discussion points? Oh, you have it. May I borrow for something? Thank you. So just for the sake of completeness, this would add a new line to Schedule 3, limited time parking, King Street, again, northeasterly side, 15 minutes from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Saturday, from a point 237 feet southerly of Trumbull Road to a point 257 feet southerly of Trumbull Road. That's what we're at, a 20-foot parking space along King Street. So I would just say, I mean, I actually have never met a 15-minute parking space I don't like. I think they have a clear public benefit. They encourage spaces to turn over and create more parking, essentially. If I'm not mistaken, is this our only 15-minute parking space on King Street? Can't remember. Is it? Okay. Yeah, we had a number of them created administratively, and either the beginning of this year or the end of last, we put them into the code. So I think they're excellent for the downtown area, personally. Any other comments? Okay. Well, we have a motion on the floor, so all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, the next item on the agenda, I think. Is there anyone here from Federal Street? Okay, a couple folks. We have a traffic calming application that was received on November 1st, 2015 for Federal Street. And I would request that would one of you deputize the other to come and explain, kind of introduce this to us?
I think I've been deputized.
Great. Congratulations.
I don't want to speak.
I don't know. And if you would just please give your name and address for the record.
Sure. I'm Tracy Levy. I live on 196 Federal Street.
What are the basic issues and what motivated the residents to bring this forward?
So in the last 4 years, in the area of Federal Street between Riverside and Elm-Nonotuck, there's not only a nursing home where people take their wheelchairs and go for a stroll, there are now over 10 children that are under the age of 8 and 4 children between ages of 12 and 15, and there are no sidewalks. As well as there's a rise in the road, so that there's areas that you can be driving on that street and have no idea what's in front of you. In addition, it's sort of a cut through from downtown Florence to sort of Route 9 and closer to downtown Northampton. So people are speeding on that street. And it's petrifying as a parent of a 3-year-old and a 5-year-old, you know, to tell them they have to stay in the grass. Yes, I know they want to visit their friends next door, but they can't actually go into the street to do that because cars are just speeding all the time. And watching folks in their wheelchairs on a beautiful fall day going for a stroll in the middle of a street where there are cars speeding by is also petrifying. So as a neighborhood for the last 2 years, we've been noticing this and deciding, okay, it's time to do something about this. And that's why so many of us responded by signing this petition and writing those letters. We would love, if possible, I know that the traditional means of doing this is to do a study, and then to sort of a few years later, maybe something will happen. If there's any way that something could be expedited so that we don't have to wait until somebody gets hurt for something to be done, because I think all of us on the street are just getting scared every day. But the bus stop is literally, there's no sidewalks. So the children, ages 5 and older, are literally on a corner, hoping that the cars that are speeding by don't speed by and hurt anybody.
Thank you. Okay. Is there any other comment from residents on this application? Okay. You alluded to the process, and I'll summarize it. What we would do here today is potentially vote to start a traffic study and that would take, collect data on traffic volume and speed and types of vehicles and so forth. And the reason we do that is we will take that data and bring it back and vote again about whether to assign this project a ranking, because there are many, maybe about two dozen at this point, active traffic calming applications. And as you point out, there are restrictions and constrictions to getting them done. One of them is money. And so we need to have a fair process, and we have a point, about 100 point or so ranking system to decide where each project falls in the queue. Resident support is one, and traffic speed and a variety of other factors also contribute to its overall score. And so if we move forward with the study today, we'd return and then assign it a ranking later. So that's what the commission would do today. Now, is there any comment from the commission members or questions on this particular traffic calming application?
Just for some background information, what's the speed limit on Federal Street, and is it posted in various places?
I don't know.
One of the points that we have indicates it's 30.
So it is posted as 30. Any other questions or comments? Is there any problem with starting the process and collecting data in this case?
No.
Okay.
Only the temperature.
Right. Well, would anyone like to make a motion to request the DPW begin the traffic?
So moved.
Second. Mr. Hartwell makes the motion. Director Fine seconds. Any further discussion on this? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. So we'll be back in touch. We'll start the process, gather data, and we'll revisit this.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your time. Okay. Let's see. We have a trio of parking issues in Florence. So let's try and solve all of them.
yes.
There we go. No promises. The discussion item number one is parking issues on Bird's Pit Road. This is brought to us by Melissa Nuttleman. Ms. Nuttleman, I don't know if you'd like to describe the problems briefly to the commission. That would be helpful.
I'm delighted I'm going to be one of the brief items. My name is Melissa Nuttleman. I live on Bird's Pit Road. I'm also on the Smith Vocational Land Use Committee that's put together by Jeff Peterson, who's the superintendent of Smith Volk. The land is not the issue in this case, but the people that are using the land are parking on either side of Bird's Pit Road on the lower end. That is situated past the community gardens and the playing fields. As you go up past Forks Library, instead of continuing on 66, you go on to Prince Street for a little bit, and then that's the bottom part, or what I refer to as the lower part of Bird's Pit Road. So the property is under lease to Volk under law of the Department of Agriculture, which is zoned agricultural use. And over a period of years, there is now a 25-year review after, as part of the 99-year lease. So the school is moving towards making the property more agricultural use only, and they're working with the community to try and sort of facilitate that process. This is problematic because the property hasn't been signed, meaning there hasn't been signage to indicate how it should be used. So over time, because it hasn't been defined as to what it should be used for, it's been used by the general population. It's very popular, particularly on the weekends. Both in-town people as well as out-of-town people are using it for walking and running, and I'm sure everyone has a story about it somewhere and some background. The trustees have voted to approve Jeff's initial plan, which calls for recreational use under specific rules, which are posted in the parking area off of Burke's Pit Road. And in moving to make it more agricultural use, he's cleared the trees, pushed back the parking lot, there's now waste receptacles, so it looks more like a park than it ever did before. That being said, it now feels like there are more people using it. There were over 500 people on it just this last weekend, and it's in November. The most popular times are during the summer because people use the access in the pleasant weather and then also to get down to the river. Again, there's a whole bunch of other people that have got different kinds of issues associated with it. My concern specifically is the safety on the roads. The area that is where most of the people park is clearly off the road, but many people don't feel comfortable parking in that parking lot, so they're parking on either side of Burke's Pit Road. The area is, the pictures that are taken here are, in all fairness, worst case scenario. So on a Tuesday afternoon, there's school students that are running, there's people that are walking dogs, there's people that are using it recreationally, and that's where you see the school bus parked in the road. The left side actually has off-road parking over by the playing fields, and they're not used. That parking space is not used, and part of the parking space isn't being used on a regular basis. So what you see is the trees that are grown up on either side of the road create a shading process. People are parking on the side of the road on both sides of that hill, because the 258 acres goes from Route 66 all the way down to the Mill River. So it's a massive piece of property. So the number of the property can absorb a number of people, but they have no place to actually park their vehicles because most people are coming from a different place. So I'm asking for assistance in what the process is. The emergency exit from the county jail on the far side of the hill is being blocked by people that are parking there. There's also a fire hydrant right there. As well as the parking is occurring on both of the curves over the hill. And of course, people are walking back and forth across the property. So any support that you can provide, a process that you can outline or make us aware. Now my information comes from different people, so I haven't personally vetted it, but if you contact the jail, they say they're waiting for the city to do something, that they can't send a guard over every single time somebody happens to randomly park in front of their exit. If you ask why we can't ticket people, it's because it's not marked, no parking. If you ask people to move, some of them say they've always parked here, they have the right to do so. They don't seem to understand that the sign that says keep out applies to them. They think that they're different. So I'm looking for a process that we can follow to make it a little bit safer, particularly before it freezes up and the ice becomes problematic because water drains off on both sides. The DPW is awesome about treating it. So, you know, it's a question of how cars are going to park once the snow comes. The rules changed in October according to who uses the property, and the parking space was opened up in late spring, and that's resulted in a significant increase in the number of the people that are parking. There had previously been random people parking, now it seems to be much more prevalent.
Okay, thank you very much. Other questions for Ms. Nunham? Ms. Horst?
Did you say that people are not using the parking lot that's available?
That's correct. If you drive by and you see cars parked literally on the road, there is still space in the parking lot. So Jeff offered to, I think one of the pictures kind of shows it. He's got some boulders along the side because he was thinking that that would keep people from parking on the second page where you see that white vehicle. And they're actually now fitting themselves between the boulder and the road. So he was reluctant to push the boulders further closer to the road. He doesn't want to have a problem, you know, with the city. He was just trying to delineate things in the old farm way of putting up some boulders.
So my understanding is that there's the parking lot on the right-hand side.
Correct.
And then there's a parking lot that's back by the field?
The city has a parking lot by the playing fields.
Right.
But that's not where the people who want to use the, I'm going to call it state hospital property because I'm of that age, who want to use that property want to egress. In other words, they're accessing the property in the area off of that parking lot. There's a big loop which is actually approved for recreational use temporarily by the trustees while they move to work with the state to bring the entire parcel under compliance. Does that answer your question?
I'm just wondering if there's any way to highlight the availability of that other parking lot more?
So that parking lot is often gated when there's no games going on.
Is that what it is?
And when there's games going on, obviously recreation needs it. But there is, as you said, there's still the parking on what you're describing to the right side.
They're not utilizing it.
Yeah, because that space is there without
it. It's even bigger now than it used to be.
Yeah, separated it and he moved it back, exactly. Yeah, in order to kind of encourage people to get off the road.
There are two issues that I've heard about why people aren't inclined to use that parking lot, and that is one, I haven't been there in a while, but the condition of the parking lot itself was so poor that people didn't want to drive into it because of the ruts.
That's changed.
That has changed?
Yeah, he fixed that.
So then the other thing that used to be an issue on and off was that there were break-ins quite a bit, and people chose not to park, wanted to be on the street so that there was more kind of, you know, visibility of their cars and things like that. And I don't know if that's something that the police department has addressed or other, if that's changed, but I know that was for many years a kind of a fear of a lot of folks that park.
We haven't had any this year. We did address it. It had been a problem for multiple years in a row. They were really inconsistent when they occurred there, but it was usually during the daytime, and so we did have people up there, and ultimately we haven't had any over this summer. I can't even think of one.
So it's an issue that can be improved with signage, requesting people park in the lot?
I do think between that lot and the back entrance to the jail, that it's not really a safe place to park. We've had complaints in the past about runners just feeling uncomfortable, not aware of any accidents, but being uncomfortable because it's very narrow. So I actually think that's an area that might make sense, you know, where the road's curving to have no parking. I'm not actually sure the jail hasn't seemed to come out that way, so that one's less of a concern, but just where the road's curving is not safe.
Other thoughts on that particular point? I mean, establishing no parking along that length? I mean, that would, if cars obey that, wouldn't have cars parking there. So. I mean, I guess I'm trying to understand the lot also. I mean, is it just the case that people don't want to use, it sounds like the public safety issues maybe aren't what they used to be, and the road seems to be repaired, so why aren't people using the lot? If that's
I don't know. I mean, I would feel more comfortable if they just parked in the lot because there's so much activity near the road where it's dark and close over and that type of thing. Jeff did indicate that for those people, he grants permission, you know, like if they're having an event, Smith uses it a couple times a year, Smith College uses it a couple times a year, you know, that he could call out the people that, you know, the approval to use the property is conditional on the fact that you need to park in the parking lot, if you will. And the other thing I'm not sure of is whether, you know, people think, oh, I'm not supposed to be here, so if I'm not parking in the parking lot, then, you know, it's not like I'm parking illegally on somebody's property. I'm not really sure. We've talked to a number of different people. You know, the land use team that Jeff put together has met many different times trying to anticipate, you know, what is, why people are doing what they're doing, and it isn't really clear.
The lot on Smithville police property,
yes.
There's no sign to prevent people from parking, so anyone could park if they want to?
No, there isn't. In fact, it looks a little welcoming as far as, you know, there's a trash receptacle, there's signs, you know, I mean, there's usually people parking there sun up to sundown, so maybe that's changed the nature of feeling more comfortable for some people. Not sure. He pushed it back, too, so that, you know, there is more space, and he graded the road so that it's... not the big bump thing that you're thinking of in the spring, yeah.
And it's been an evolution the last, I don't know, 5 or 6 years. It used to be everyone used a lot and no one parked on the street except when it was overflow, and then you're right,
that's right.
Switch.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, if we established no parking along a certain length, that made sense. It wouldn't be punitive. People would have a place to park in the lot, right? Mm-hmm. And does it make sense for today to sort of agree that we may bring back an ordinance to do that for discussion in a future meeting? And we can debate that as a specific solution, yes or no.
And I'd add, once you get beyond the curve in Burke's Pit Road, you're on the west side, then I think it's fine for parking there. So there's overflow and people want to be out of the parking lot. There's an option there. It's really just where Burke's Pit curves and goes around that line.
Okay.
That's where it feels like the safety issue is, and I'm not a safety person by any means. I will tell you that Jeff didn't want to put any additional signage or boulders or anything on that area that's across from where the compost and the barns are, because the long fields are used for haying, and it would affect his ability to turn his equipment and things like that. So, and there hasn't been, to the best of my knowledge, any concern with people parking there. It's the other side where it's so congested.
Well, does anyone have any other general comments on this? I don't think we need a motion on this, but would the Department of Public Works be willing to kind of give us some measurements in coordination with, I don't know, maybe planning about the length along the road where we might prohibit parking?
Mm-hmm.
And then we can bring back to the next meeting.
Sure.
Specifically. Okay. So we'll just resolve to do that. That was responsive.
Not related to anything the commission's going to do, but Melissa, maybe a suggestion to take that to your committee would be, as you're making changes with the land and waiting for state compliance, maybe have the Gazette come out and do a piece with some pictures where you could get the suggestions into the Gazette, such as these are the areas where you're suggesting parking, maybe these improvements to this lot over here. Just get something out for some PR.
Okay, that's a great idea. I'll let them know. Thank you very much for your time.
Activate your spin machine. Thank you very much for coming. Okay. Item number two are parking issues on Pine Street. We have Ann Wassell. And we heard from Ann at public comment last time, but now she has her own agenda item. So feel free to bring us back up to speed.
Yes, so my name is Ann Wassell. I live at 32 Pine Street on the right side. So I am here again to speak to the issue of overflow parking from the medical building at 10 Main Street onto our residential street. So it's been an ongoing issue about parking on Pine Street from that building. Before there was another group, a medical group that was in there, and they moved out and the parking on our street improved. And now there is a nursing program in there from Greenfield Community College, and we're getting all the overflow parking onto Pine Street once again. Now, given that I live at 32 Pine Street, it's right at that intersection of where Chestnut comes into Pine Street, and it's a T intersection, which is problematic in itself. I mean, there's a lot of traffic, speed and volume on Pine Street, and many cars that are coming down Chestnut Street onto Pine Street oftentimes don't stop at the stop sign and just go right around that corner and turn usually right onto Pine Street. So there's a lot of issues about that intersection in general. Now we've added, over the last couple of years with the 10 Main Street building, parking on both sides. So the sight lines have gotten really scary. And in our driveway is right where we have to back up into that intersection to get out of the driveway to our house. Originally, our house had been a single family house. We converted it with friends of ours to a two family house back in the 90s. And at the time, we're told that we absolutely had to have off-street parking for all the residents that were gonna be living in that house. So we have to park front to back of each other. There's four cars. The two family, four cars front to back. So in the mornings, if we need to move one car out so the car in front can get there, we, many mornings now during the week, have no place to put the other car because there's cars all over Pine Street that have taken up the parking. And we would like to see that, first of all, that we somehow be somewhat protected from the business community. We are really happy that Florence is vibrant, that it's developing, but we feel like we're a fragile neighborhood. We are a residential neighborhood, and we are getting overflow from the business community, and we want to see them take responsibility for their parking. We as residents in our house had to have off-street parking for us. I would like to see 10 Main Street take responsibility for parking for their clients, employees, whoever's there. And I would like to see that our neighborhood doesn't have to bring this up every time there's a new resident or tenant that goes into that 10th Street, Main Street building. I don't want to have to come back every single time it's an issue. We would really like to see it dealt with. So I'm asking the committee, I am in Jefferson's, a Pine Street resident. We have issues about the traffic and volume too, but I don't have other people here with me today, but I can tell you that the neighborhood is very concerned about this. And again, you package that up with that intersection, speed and volume on Pine Street, lots of parking that's there. And please, we're a residential neighborhood. We want to stay a residential neighborhood.
Thank you. Are there questions for Ms. Sill? Okay. Other residents from Pine Street?
Yeah. Okay. Hi, my name's Jefferson Pitcher, and I live about seven houses down at 12 Pine, which is just before South Main. And I would agree to everything that Ann has said. The volume of parking has made it such that we've had some work done at our house and not had a driveway for the last couple of months. Sometimes I'll take my kids to school and come home and have to park, you know, I'll circle around the block and park quite far away, given that it's a residential neighborhood. The other issue that's been exacerbated by this is the traffic, volume, and speed. And I'll just sort of briefly make my point about that. When I first moved into the home on Pine Street 4 years ago now, I contacted Laura Hansen, who at the time was involved with the Parking Commission, and said, hey, the volume is really out of control. There's lots of speeding. What can be done? And they said, well, we came out and put traffic counters on the road. I found out from neighbors that those have been placed on 4th of July weekend. The weekends, there's virtually no traffic because our street is used as a cut through to the neighborhoods out by Ryan Road. So I bugged the city and eventually contacted Owen Freeman Daniels, who helped set up the PVPC coming back out and counting traffic. To shorten the long story, they came out, put them down for a whole week, and then my life got really, really chaotic. I wrote some emails, and I never heard back regarding what the data produced. Before we moved in, the speed limit was increased on the street, which I found rather odd. And I determined that around the time that the Goggins Real Estate Building and the bank went in there on Pine Street, some traffic calming measures were supposed to take place. And for reasons that are somewhat unknown to me anyway, nothing really happened. So since I've moved in, my sister-in-law comes to visit from the eastern Massachusetts area once a week and has had her mirror, side mirror on her car, removed now 4 times, which seems sort of outrageous in a relatively small, you know, 2 year time period. The carpenters who have been working on our house have had their mirrors removed, each of them twice. So I don't know how familiar you all are with Pine Street, but it bottlenecks down at the end between Chestnut and South Main. It gets rather narrow. And so when there are a lot of cars, people are sort of fighting to see, you know, two cars can't really fit if there's anybody parked there. So the other issue that happens is people are hurrying to get to school, to get their kids to school, they're hurrying home from work, and they get frustrated because it's somewhat ambiguous as to how they're going to fit, so they get angry. And the amount of times I have been flipped off and yelled at for pulling into my driveway or getting my kids out of the car, I've had something thrown at me, it's quite frustrating. This is not a problem that we can probably solve in a room like this. This is a cultural issue. Solving this culturally might take 20 years. So I've been hoping for a long time that we can solve it in an easier manner, which would be some form of traffic calming that would reduce the degree of ambiguity on the street. It would give people more room so that they wouldn't be so angry. If it was really, really clear, and one proposal from Mark Carmine, who's a realtor who worked in the Goggins building for many years, was he suggested like on Laurel Street, which is sort of an oddly angled street across from the community gardens. He said they made that street one way, and he proposed for a long time that from Chestnut to South Main, Pine Street be made one-way heading out towards Ryan Road, so that the traffic coming down Pine Street would be then diverted out Chestnut to Main Street, so the section that's so narrow would be less ambiguous. In looking at traffic calming measures that have happened in other areas, I mean, roundabouts, which the city seems to be embracing in lots of areas, are great. In Sacramento, California, they've put lots of, for lack of a better word, obstacles in the middle of roads, large cement planters, which force cars to slow down so that they don't hit the planter, makes it really clear which side each car has to go around. There's also no sidewalk from South Main up until Chestnut on the north side of the street. That was another proposal. So anyway, I just want to mention that in addition to the parking, that I think Pine Street has a handful of problems that perhaps could be discussed, or at least discussed addressing those problems all simultaneously.
Okay, thank you. Other questions for Mr. Pitcher right now? And to add to that, we also have a discussion about parking on Chestnut Street coming up next. So I don't know if it's the commission's pleasure just to move to that, because it seems like to one extent or another, they're all going to be related in the same neighborhood. One thing I would like to know on this, I mean, do we have any institutional knowledge about the data that was gathered? It sounds like there were traffic counters and so forth.
We have a draft study from PDPC on Pine Street.
Okay.
Also, I'm not sure it's the same thing as the study that you're remembering, and I wasn't involved in this, but there's some threatened litigation when the Co-op Bank in Goggins developed there. There was some money set aside for traffic mitigation, and there was some process where the neighborhood worked together trying to find a consensus. And I wasn't part of that, so I'm not sure where it went. But there may be some documentation. Maybe that's what Ned did. I don't know enough about the details.
Do you think, in fact, it's possible we might have traffic mitigation money lying underneath the report somewhere?
I don't know. My office doesn't. I think it was some sort of agreement that was made. I know Mark Canna was the attorney for somebody. I'm not sure if it was neighbors or for
right.
the developers.
He's still on Pine Street.
Okay.
And he is a previous owner of my house, actually,
okay.
before Bill Childs owned my house. And I know that Pine Street was on the list for traffic calming. It was fairly low down on the list, which was part of my sort of inquiry into the whole situation, because I thought, well, that data seems flawed, because when I contacted Laura, she said, oh, there's very little traffic on Pine Street. I said, well, that's absurd. And I don't know relative to what, but there's a lot of traffic on Pine Street. So the PVPC came back out and counted again, and so I thought that the likelihood that would have moved Pine Street higher up the list was fairly good, but I don't know, because if I'm not mistaken, Laura moved on is elsewhere. You have a question?
I just wanted to get a point of clarification. Did the PVPC used to do these traffic studies before this was kind of instituted by the DPW? We haven't come across this in my 2 years.
They allow a community to have up to two studies a year. If we go down Bridge Road to school with the speed counters and the pedestrian counts, they allow those to be done twice a year by a community upon request from the mayor. Other than that, they'll do them for service here. I said, I'm pretty sure that we have a draft report on Pine Street.
Sounds like that would be pretty important to take a look
yep.
at. Yeah.
And would the data need to be translated so that it fits into the prioritization that we have from the internally completed studies?
I'm not quite following the question.
So if a different entity essentially carried out this traffic study,
mm-hmm.
do we need to do our analysis so that we can rank it according to, rank the outcome according to our standards as opposed to PVPC's?
I don't know if we'd have to compare them to each other or not. I mean, PVPC has historically done very good work for the city of the past. And we'd probably look at their report, make any recommendations, and then follow through on it. I said, let me find the report and take a look at it.
So it wouldn't fit into the prioritization that we have based on studies that have been.
If there's a traffic calming request for Pine Street, I mean, obviously it'd be studying recommendations that are done and it's matter of financing. It
sounds like it would fit into the traffic calming process that we've established, just the data comes from Pioneer Valley Planning Commission rather than the Department of Public Works. It also sounds like perhaps there's new data that was collected that might affect where it falls in the ranking.
That's what I was questioning, yeah.
Potentially. Well, for this meeting, I mean, would it be sufficient to say we've heard about the issue and we want to do some research and revisit it?
Of course.
Okay. I think that's what we've asked at this point. And then we'll be in touch about future meetings.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you.
And if you want to...
Can I just ask, in all of this, obviously there's some information out there about the volume and traffic, but how is the parking issue going to fit into that?
That's true.
And, you know, and I don't know whether this committee has any sway over encouraging businesses to provide adequate parking in some other ways, whether it's carpooling or, you know, off-site, off-campus parking. I don't want the parking issue to get lost in
all this. No, thanks, you're absolutely right. I mean, yeah, there's parking and there's the existing traffic data.
Yeah.
Let's split them in half. Let's research the traffic data we have, come back. And then parking, why don't we keep that simmering and then move to Chestnut, parking on Chestnut Street, because I would think that's related. Mm-hmm. So would that be okay?
Mm-hmm.
Let's do that. So unless there's any objection, I'd like to move to discussion item three. Is Daniel Rao here? Rao. Sorry for mangling.
Rao.
Whose ever name I'm going to mangle the process of this. Yeah, would you bring us up to speed if you would on the parking issue of Chestnut?
So I live at 5355 Chestnut Street. Basically, the part of the street that has problems is between the intersection with Main Street and the bike path crosswalk. And we seem to be having similar problems with people parking for 10 Main Street on our street from early in the morning all day. Usually by 4 o'clock they're cleared out, and then this started around the time, I think, that the signs and the spots went in on Middle Street, which is right across from 10 Main Street. They were having problems with people parking. So it seems like we're now having the same issue, people parking right up to our driveways. We can't see to get in and out of our driveways. Some of us have to back out or back in and can't do that anymore. The addition of the pie shop has exacerbated that problem as well, with employees of the pie shop parking on our street. The fact that we don't have any signs saying to where we're parking or any kind of limitation, and also the no parking signs in certain spots are faded behind trees, badly placed. People are parking there all day long. They're parking very badly without any repercussions because there's no signs saying they can't do that. I call the police often and, you know, ask them to give tickets because people are parked blocking our driveways, and yeah, it just seems like the 10 Main Street might need to have some responsibility, and you know, where the, if they're providing parking for all of the things that are going on over there, as well as, you know, new businesses coming in. I don't know if they have to have some kind of, you know, approval before they come in, that, you know, they have enough parking for their employees, or not sure how that works. But then we have the issue of all these people parking on our streets. As I sent you the pictures, you can see, you can't really see people at the crosswalk. So, you know, people biking and, you know, walking across, which I do every day, you know, it's a little more treacherous, but our crosswalk is in a bit of a dip in the road. So people tend to kind of fly through there, and I can see it from my window, and you know, people are waiting to get by because there's cars parked on both sides, and they're waiting to get through, and then when they do, they gun it through the crosswalk, and you know, make it just killing visibility there. No, am I missing anything? So basically, snow is going to be an issue. We have a few no parking signs near the end of the street right before the light. People tend to ignore them. They're not very visible. And when people park there, then if there are other cars at the light, you can't actually get down the street. So it seems like it needs to be rethought, and maybe, you know, with the more volume of people parking and people cutting through our street, that there needs to be something done.
Okay. Got it. Thank you. Are there any questions for Ms. Rayo? Are there other residents of Chestnut Street who'd like to add to this? Or have concerns about Chestnut Street?
Yeah, yes, I'll say a few words. My name is Peter Newsom. We own 47 Chestnut Street, which is the house immediately behind the new pie bar and sort of kitty-cornered opposite Cooper's there. We've owned the house for 10 years, so we've seen various changes take place with more and more cars. Outside or to the side of the pie bar, the other barbers, there's a bus stop. Now, since the pie bar's been there, I've seen cars, and well, we're not there all the time, but we're there now mowing the lawn, looking after the house, that sort of thing, just sitting there with the flashers on idling while they're running in to get a pie. As there are signs that are saying no parking, that sign's been bent, so it's not clear. We got a tree put there on the corner to stop people parking up on that verge there, which, you know, which has just been repaired. That whole street, that whole area has been relayed. There's been new mains, I believe, and so forth. Well, the curb outside the house has been mangled with trucks and so forth. I've had a few words with Coopers because they have a huge 18-wheeler that comes down that street and tries to get in there. Now, some of their drivers are very, very good. I actually congratulated a lady driver who did the best parking job of an 18-wheeler I've ever seen, and that's why I congratulated her, but most of them are not that good. We had some people, this is some years ago, training there, and they knocked through our hedge down, they hit the telegraph pole. The big problem with all that is I've also seen an ambulance with its lights flashing not being able to get through, because people come in the other way, okay? It just causes it has potential dangerous outcomes for anybody in that situation. Now, that situation's only on a Tuesday, okay? But since the pie bar has opened up, and let's say we all want new businesses because we want the town to be vibrant. It provides income for the city, it provides a few jobs, and it's another place for, you know, we ought to go to and eat and enjoy ourselves. However, there doesn't seem to have been much thought as to how all these people, once they get there, where they're going to put their cars. And this is what has happened. It was bad enough at sometimes that area, because it's not wide enough. And I come from London. Now, I don't know if you've ever been there, but we have cars parked by the side, and you know, you have to breathe in if you're driving down the streets, because you miss very, very closely. So I understand the problem. I also understand that if the car's licensed and registered, it's perfectly has a legal right to be on the streets. But there must be some form of compromise that can be achieved so that the safety issue is taken care of. Our issues with regards to getting in and out of driveways are issues. We've got problems when we have contractors. Sometimes if they've got, especially doing lawns and lawnmower, they can't park in the driveways. If they're there trying to get lawnmowers out, it's just chaos. And I have no idea what's going to happen once the snow comes, because then we're going to have even more problems. Because if people still park, you'll be lucky to get a bicycle down the side. Plus the fact people do zoom down there because it's a shortcut from there down to Bridge Road, because it parallels North Maple, okay? So they use it like that. Perhaps, I don't know, you could put sleeping policemen, as they're called, the little road bumps across to slow traffic down. That might be a thing, but that won't relieve the parking problem. One-way system, who knows? There's all sorts, even permit parking, but then we have the problems if we're having, friends over and family over, where is everybody else going to park? Because the driveways are small. We can only get maybe 2, 3, possibly 4 cars on. So where are those people going to park? So I realize that there's no easy solution to this, but something has, I think, got to be done.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah. Well, thank you. Any questions for Mr. Newsom?
Any questions for me?
I just have a very quick thought, observing all this in the neighborhood. I also observe that there are a lot of parking lots in Florence that often seem like there are very few cars in them. I don't know how familiar you all are. There's one by the paint store. There's one by the hardware store. There's one behind the bank. there are a lot of lots, and I'm on the bike path a lot, and I often notice that the lots are at sort of half capacity. It's just a thought. I don't know if there's a way to like figure out how to utilize those lots better because there's so much parking trouble in the Florence core.
Mm-hmm. Is there anyone else who'd like to comment on Chestnut?
I'm the neighbor between the two neighbors. So I'm Debbie Lizeski of 51 Chestnut Street. And my concern for myself is that since the high car has opened, the kind of driveway that I have, I prefer to back in into my carport so I can pull out, because Chestnut Street's not an easy street to pull out backing into. So my day is I come home and I want to be able to back into my driveway. But where the cars have been parking, they literally have been parking their butt on one side of my driveway with the front end on the other side of a car that's parking in front of a no parking sign. They're trying to fit in between this parking sign that says no parking to the corner and my driveway. So guaranteed, if you don't have a smart car, you're not going to fit with the, I believe the legal limit is 3 feet to a driveway. I took a picture today just because I came home and I found that situation. And it's a little bit frustrating to see this and deal with it on at least 2 to 3 times a week. So, and the biggest concern for me as well is the thought about winter coming. If you've ever been on Chestnut Street in the winter, you know it's one of the streets that the DPW has to go down and remove snow because two cars can't get by when we get the snow that we get. And where are the cars going to go that are trying to park on the street? I just can't imagine. That was my concern.
Okay.
I want to address.
No, I appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that with us. Are there any other comments?
Can I say one more thing? It really seems like the signage on Middle Street and the actual parking spots that they painted seem to help. I've talked to some people on that street, and it would help with our situation as well, so we don't have people park there from early in the morning all afternoon to have, you know, 2-hour parking. It is, you know, within a block of downtown. It shouldn't be long-term parking. And just to have spots, you know, painted so people know how close they can be to the driveways, because it seems like most people don't know the rule of 3 feet from a driveway. And also, there are people parking right up to the crosswalk. Like, literally between a driveway and the crosswalk, there's enough space for a car, and I don't know that that's legal, but it seems like it's definitely dangerous.
And of course, if we had 2-hour parking, it would apply to residents as well.
Well, their signs are 2-hour parking from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Mm-hmm. So I feel like if, you know, residents needed to park overnight, it wouldn't be a problem. But then, actually, I have another question. Is there parking enforcement in Florence?
Yes, there is.
Okay. I have to call the police quite often, and it seems like they don't always know what the rules are, and then there's no... I've seen the parking enforcement car drive down our street a few times and drive right by a bunch of cars that are violating.
The thing about the crosswalk is that the ordinance as it reads is no parking in a crosswalk, meaning on the crosswalk,
okay.
or any yeah. portion of the car into the crosswalk, or within 10 feet of the crosswalk when posted.
Okay, yeah, so that's the thing. We don't really have any
signs.
The only thing we have is a few faded no parking signs between the intersection and Deb's house, but they're in bad spots. They don't really make much sense. I think it's just because the trucks for Coopers need to be able to get in and to keep the, if people are at the light, to keep cars being able to get through. But, yeah.
Okay,
cool. I did have a conversation with a representative from the new nursing program yesterday about that program. That was the first time I knew that the program was going in there. So, you know, we had a chat about the students and the parking. And I did
emphasize to her that the 3 feet to the edge of a driveway, not parking for extended periods of time. Unfortunately, there isn't the 2-hour only parking signs in place, but as far as Chestnut, Pine, and Middle, we did talk extensively about the overflow onto those streets and what the ordinance as they stand right now are. So I did try and jump on that. You know, we're all very concerned about this overflow.
Yeah, because there are several dead-end streets to the right and the left of Chestnut Street that wouldn't have this amount of traffic going by and wouldn't be as dangerous for people to be getting out of their driveways. And it seems like maybe, you know, to spread them out a little bit and not have them always, you know, it's always the same cars in front of our house and they park on both sides, which, you know, maybe one side would make more sense. But yeah, then it limits the parking for the residents too. I have a 4-family house, you know, I have enough parking for all of my tenants to have 2 spots, but sometimes they have guests and, like, you know, they can't park on the street now. But yeah, a lot of issues.
15 minutes almost up there.
Well, yeah. Well, people tend to make their own 15-minute parking spots when they're, for some reason, I'm getting pie is an excuse for ignoring all parking times. And so.
Well, I'd like to thank you.
Sure.
Do you have, and
can I just make one, I'll try to make this short.
And then we want to jump into kind of discussing what you might
do. Okay. So, you know, I'm hearing Chestnut talk about sort of the problems that are there the same as ours. But a lot of it, I think, coming from 10 Main Street because it is the larger building, so there's a lot more, you know, employees and clients that are in there. Middle Street had it addressed. And so what happened is that Middle Street's problem became Chestnut Street and Pine Street's problem. And I would like to see 10 Main Street deal with this problem rather than having us as residents have to be addressing it. I would like them to take responsibility for this. Again, we are residential neighborhoods that are being heavily impacted by a business community, and darn, I feel like they need to find their parking and not lap it over onto our residential streets.
So you, for example, you would want them to expand a parking lot?
That, get off-campus parking, shuttle or carpool. I worked at Bay State Medical Center for many years, and if anybody's been in Springfield, then you know, I think Bay State was very responsive. The same thing happened. Employees were parking on the residential streets, and the residents were up in arms. And Bay State, they did something about it, and they were making sure that that didn't happen. And they now have off-campus parking, and yes, you have to get yourself from there. They provide a shuttle, but I think there are ways that it could be dealt with and that we shouldn't have to come up with all the solutions for their building.
I would like to have a bit more of a conversation about this right now with the commission, and thank you to everyone who made the comments. I would note, first of all, that just so everyone knows, there is an active traffic calming application for Chestnut Street. It was before changes on Middle Street, and it was before the Pie Bar, but I think it's still relevant, and so that
it's a really different issue, though. When they started that,
if you don't mind, I'm so sorry. Yeah, let me just. Would you like to add more information? What I want to do is just summarize what I've heard.
Well, the traffic calming they started that about last year, and that was for people speeding on the street, and it was mostly the people on the other end of Chestnut Street that were concerned because people cut through and speed. But this has really changed with all the parking issues.
Well, I can tell you, I don't want to debate it.
Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
An active traffic on the application for Chestnut Street, and whether we revisit it because of a new situation, that might be possible. Okay. But anyway, that is in the works. The other thing I'd say is, I mean, there's growing pains here, and there's a bit of squeezing a water balloon. If you make changes on Middle Street, it has effects for other streets, and I think that's to be expected. So the way this seems to break out to me is there's existing prohibitions on where you can't park, and you may have problems with faded signage, okay? And that sounds like that's something that we could fairly easily address, in theory, is replacing signage. And then you have problems of volume, which unless we're going to have the businesses move their parking to the other side of the city, we're going to continue to have. So the question would be, how do we deal with that? And the question would be, in my mind, do we want to take what we did on Middle Street and try it elsewhere on Chestnut or Pine Street? I don't know if that makes sense to anyone else, but I can't really think of any other possible solutions. Please.
I know that I have heard from parking enforcement officers as well as residents on Middle Street who said that the actual marked parking spaces, as was pointed out earlier, has truly helped because people know exactly where they can park, and if they're outside of that space, then they can easily be taken. So that is one thing that may very well help with keeping people from parking on top of driveways. So that's just one suggestion that I wanted to throw out there.
Yeah, I mean, I'll add what you started with, Ryan, what you added. I'm much more sympathetic to all the specific horror stories people have of cars blocking driveway access and cars parked where they shouldn't be. I'm less sympathetic, frankly, and I think it's wonderful that Florence is booming, that requires people parking spaces. So I'd rather at least first fix all the things in terms of marking spaces and figure out where cars shouldn't be and putting signs up and doing enforcement, and at least see what happens for all that before we start thinking about your residents only parking or time limit. And maybe we still have to come back, but I'm not saying we shouldn't look at this, but it just seems like there's a lot of low-hanging fruit to solve a lot of people's specific nightmares.
Well, if we were to list the low-hanging fruit, it would be marking actual spaces on Chestnut Street. It'd be replacing old signage. It'd be putting signage where you might need it. And Ms. Forrester, you brought something up about distance. But maybe that's irrelevant if we're marking spaces.
Right, we would have to put signage in to say no parking within 10 feet of a crosswalk.
Oh, that's for the crosswalk, okay.
That's for the crosswalk.
Okay. Mr. Harwell, you had
a... I was just curious if looking at all the ordinances on the book about parking in Florence, and you know, what are the limits? So the signs may end at a certain point, but should those be extended further? If you have no parking zones, are they... other places where you can put parking instead of no parking. Thinking about Jason Schreiber's lectures about what you see when you go in the community, lots of no parking. Well, where is the parking? So they're kind of okay.
I'd also like to come at this from a little bit of a different angle, just hearing about the concerns with the business community in Florence, and I'm wondering if the residents wouldn't want to approach the Florence Business and Civic Association to maybe set up a meeting between residents of these streets and management of the 10 Florence Street Practice, the Pie Bar, and see, you know, hear from them what they've struggled with as a business community, and for them to get a sense from you folks, you know, what the kinds of issues you're dealing with are. Because I think that we need to think kind of holistically on top of these, you know, addressing particular issues around how to mark spots and all of that and what kind of signage needs to go up. It feels like there is something a little bit more complex here that needs to be sorted out between the two communities, the residents and the business community there. So I don't know if there's a leader of your group or somebody in particular who feels like they can approach the Florence Civic and Business Association. You might want to also contact counselor for Ward 5, David Murphy, to kind of spearhead something. I see people kind of smiling and covering their faces. I'm not sure why, but that's what I would suggest.
The only other thing I'd observe is I'm not sure that we'll be able to craft a comprehensive solution right now. So in terms of the process, I mean, could we ask one department to catalog signage that should be replaced? That's the Department of Public Works or Parking Enforcement. Could Parking Enforcement do that?
Sure. We can bring it to your attention. Okay. Rich could take a look at it.
Okay, so we'll look at all the signage that clearly needs to be fixed. Is it appropriate to rush right now to painting spaces on Chestnut? Is that acceptable to the neighborhood? Is that advisable? I mean, is that, we don't often do it in Florence, so.
Big question is whether or not you're going to miss the envelope with the weather now.
Well, there's the timing of it is difficult no matter what. So. And the other thing is 15-minute spaces, I think, are worth looking at, as someone suggested.
No. That will affect us negatively. That's not fair to the residents.
Not even on Main Street?
Oh, on Main Street. Sorry, I thought you meant on Chestnut Street.
No, I...
And of course, 15-minute spots are tend to be near congested business areas and are only from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m., not overnight.
There tends to be open spots on Main Street when people are coming to the businesses and parking on our street. I'll walk around the corner and there'll be four open spots. So I don't know. I don't know. Is our street wide enough to have parking spots painted? Is that, I don't know what.
Well, here's a recommendation just for today, because we have spent quite a bit of time on this. Between Pine Street and Chestnut Street, as we should. And again, I'm thankful you've taken your time to come and tell us about it and bandy these ideas around. For today, can we acknowledge that there are a certain number of low-hanging fruit options, that parking enforcement is going to do a survey of all the signage, but maybe for the next meeting we can bring actual specific items to debate, you know, and we can be in touch offline a little bit between the Department of Public Works and the residents, and we can bring, for example, a proposal to paint lines, or maybe put up, you know, signs indicating to our parking or something like that. But let's hash out the details with the neighborhood and bring it to a future meeting, because I'm not confident we're going to be able to do that effectively right now.
Are we looking at Pine Street in this?
I would
think
so.
Including Pine Street in this?
And of course, we also have related issues on Pine Street, like the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission study and that kind of thing. So if that'd be acceptable, I think that might be a good outcome for today. I just ask, is there any other information the residents would like to provide this time? Otherwise, it's just we follow up at our next meeting. I'm sorry there's no simple solutions, but you know that from living here. Okay. Well, I think that'll be our consensus then. We'll move on and revisit it. Okay. Thank you. So we are at quarter past, and we still have a lot on our agenda. We have a crosswalk that we discussed. We also have several crosswalk-related reports, and I kind of like to do those first since they may inform the specific crosswalk we're looking at. Item four is subcommittee updates, bicycle and pedestrian subcommittee. Mr. Platt, I don't know if there's any other non-crosswalk-related reports to give on that.
No, I mean, you know, we've brought committee up today. I think it's critical during the time.
Okay. And then item five is related. It's a report on data gathering that we've been kind of going through for the past year about the total crosswalk inventory of the city. Unless there's anything specific on that, I think it mostly rolls into item six, which is the item Director Fiden wanted to raise. Which is an update on planned pedestrian, bicycle, and complete streets, a comprehensive plan, including a study of crosswalks.
So this is just sort of an update. We had an embarrassment of, we wanted to do a bike and ped plan, and we applied for various grants, thinking that some would come through and some wouldn't come through, and so they all came through. So we have more money than we expected to have and actually know what to do with. And so we have an RFP on the streets right now for a master plan for bike and ped, basically bike and ped master plan, looking at complete streets, looking at crosswalks. So that's circulating. DPW commented on that on the RFP before it went out, and we received proposals on November 30th. And so we're going to move quickly, and hopefully by middle or end of December, award the contract for some. And so we actually have two different bids. Pioneer by Planning Commission is going to help do a lot of community outreach, particularly trying to get low-income neighborhoods, neighborhoods which are really hard to reach, so they're going to spend a lot of staff time doing that in terms of outreach. And they're going to hire an outside vendor to look comprehensively across the board. Everything's sort of thinking about policies, thinking about opportunities, and thinking about lists going forward. So we don't really know exactly what proposals are coming, what their approach will be, but crosswalks, bike infrastructure, pet infrastructure, down as long as the park. The RFP is publicly and wants me, I'm happy to share it. And then as they November 30th, when we get proposals, that's when we really have a lot more information.
Okay, questions on this? How do you see the crosswalk element fitting with the semi-study we started already?
So, you know, we're sort of asking the vendors to tell us how they approach that. So we gave them a list of things we want them to consider, including crosswalks. And so they're all going to give us an approach. There's two basic ways one could approach this. One is just sort of a list of projects. You know, here's 50 crosswalks you could do something on. And the other is sort of a clearer set of guidance that's out there. You know, what should the standards be? What should our priorities be? And I'm not sure how the vendors going to come in.
But we have about 600 crosswalks in the city, and you wouldn't expect the person that's awarded the contract to be looking at all 600.
No, either way. I mean, if they're doing projects, they're going to choose a limited number of projects. If they're doing sort of rules.
Okay. Are we still going to be able to carry forward some survey of our total crosswalk inventory?
Yeah. I mean, I think we want to see this first and sort of where the gaps, what we need a consultant to do, what we want to do.
Okay.
But again, I think we have sort of embarrassment of money, so we can. Should be able to do what we want to get done in this process. Between what we have a consultant doing and what FDPC does, should have enough money to help us.
Would they identify places where new crosswalks might be required?
We didn't talk about that. I think the head plan generally will talk about what are the places, you know, what are the rules for where we want crosswalks. So maybe not as much depth for those things.
Okay.
But we can certainly ask them. We're sort of doing the scope for the outside consultant first, and then figure out the gaps, and then working with PPC on the scope.
Great. Any comments on that? No? Okay. Thank you very much. Are the DPW updates long or short? Really? Ms. Chan, would you like to provide them?
Wilson Street, Maple, Clark Street, Clark Avenue. Palmer Terrace, High Street, Woods Road have been paved. They haven't been line painted yet. There's a new traffic pattern on Maple Street, so it should be less confusing which way you can go up and take a drive. For the traffic control devices on Bridge Road, they are still troubleshooting the school zone flashing lights. And one side of the RRF doesn't work. When they come out, it will also take a look. We have noticed on King Street, Main Street, and other areas in the city have been running for a few weeks ago. And traffic calming, I did put out traffic counters on Lincoln Ave. But that's just one that is learning how to do that.
Thank you very much. Any questions?
Can I say one thing? So just the Leech Rail Trail. So we had a contract. The rail trail was supposed to be done by the end of this calendar year, but we also had a standard in there for how warm it had to be for asphalt corn. The binder code, we haven't done the final wear code. DPW, David Valletta, didn't think we should waive the standard for temperature. So if they get a warm paving day between now and winter, after Thanksgiving, because the paving companies are busy, we're going to find a wearing coat, and if they don't, they're just going to put it off till the spring. We have, our contract doesn't run out in terms of our grant source until June 30th, so we can't make this at all. But my guess is we're not going to make it.
Anything else on DPW updates? Okay. So we do have one, let's see, is item four, discussion item four. This is a resident request for a crosswalk at Hampton Avenue near Hampton Court. And you heard about this at the last meeting and the meeting before that. And now it's actually formally on the agenda. So Let's see, is the commission familiar with this? This, the question is, I don't believe we have a map, but the request is to establish a new mid-block crosswalk between Hampton Court to essentially the entry of the Armory Street parking lot, with the theory that pedestrians tend to cross there anyway. So that is the request. Are there members of the public who would like to comment on that to start?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Zane Lumelski. With, I live at 20 Hampton Avenue. I'm also an officer in the Hampton Court Community Association. And so I'm representing myself and the Community Association, which formed 4 years ago, that this has been a topic all along. Before I start, Mr. Chairman, I brought more maps. If someone,
oh, great, thank you.
Someone wants them. They're the same as this. This last time. So it just indicates, it indicates where we are suggesting, which is a mid-block, and then it also suggests another location that is not a mid-block. And I also brought some other new information. I could bring this up to you, Mr. Chairman, if you like. It's, I don't think I have enough for everyone. But
take what you got.
No, of the maps. We did a petition survey.
Thank you.
So we weren't able to get to everyone, but just to very briefly review, there are 70 apartments and 7 townhouses, and we estimate a population of about 150 people. And then the other populations that would be interested in this would be the businesses. So there's about 30 employees, 35 employees, and their customers, and then also visitors to the residents. I just want to point out there's one signature on there that was a visitor, and I was going around to some of the people. She was pretty
throw the whole thing out.
Indignant. Because she had a park, she couldn't find a place to park in the Armory lot, and then she had trouble crossing the street. The other thing I'd just like to point out, I know, Mr. Chairman, that your concern, your utmost concern is safety, is probably as well as most of the members of the commission, as well as our residents, and that's in fact why we're proposing it. But you know, it keeps coming up that there's a, well, we determined at the last meeting there's no official written policy against mid-block crosswalks. The director of DPW said no, but it was frowned on. But I'm still sort of struggling about why. You know, I know that there was a fatality at a mid-block crosswalk in New South Street a few years ago, but, you know, I'm not a traffic engineer, although he's trained as an architect, and I did apprentice for a planner and a landscape architect who specialized in roads, and visibility, it seems to me, was the big issue there, because parking was allowed right up to the crosswalk, so neither the pedestrian or the driver could see each other. We don't have that problem on Hampton Avenue. There's no parking on Hampton Avenue. So, and what I tried to show with those photographs from Google is that our location is actually has better visibility. The location that is the street that feeds, that's actually a street that feeds the parking garage, because of the curve and because there's a parking lot on, as you're leaving on the right, private parking lot, there's often poor visibility there. I also went to the post office and asked them about it, just to let you know, they moved the mailbox in the last couple of days. And they told me they were planning on moving the mailbox because it was so difficult for the driver in the winter to get over the snowbank to service them. And that's another issue that we have, that, you know, during this weather, people just cross wherever they want to, and usually it's right where we're proposing. In the winter, they usually can't do that, so they go down to the driveway and walk up the street. I also want to point out, I said this before, so but maybe some of you didn't register. We have 6 people in wheelchairs and 6 to 8 people who have some other disability regarding walking, either using walker or cane or whatever. So, you know, it's pretty difficult for them to manage. You might say, well, why don't they go up to Pleasant Street? Well, if they're going to the garage or Thorns, it's, in my opinion, unrealistic to expect them to go up to Pleasant and walk all the way down. Also, oh, and the postmaster said, yes, we would like a crosswalk there as soon as possible. Apparently, that's what they said. Now that the mailbox is in the Armory parking lot, our residents are going to be crossing the street to go there. It's in line of sight. The other thing that the assistant postmaster said was, he agreed with me about exiting, I know the map calls it Kirkland, and there's some confusion about what that street's called, but anyway, exiting that road and trying to make a left, he said that's the route that the mail carrier takes, and he always has trouble. Kind of has to ease out into the street because the vision is impaired. So that's another reason why our preferred location. Now, lastly, I just, in the search for trying to find issues with mid-block crosswalks, I'm really not coming up with anything, whether it's the Federal Highway Administration or whatever. They all have guidelines on what to do, signage and markings in the street and, you know, depending upon what the conditions are, lighting and all that. But I thought this was interesting. It's from the Kansas, University of Kansas Transportation Center. I'd like to briefly quote it. A study in the early 90s involving several states showed that mid-block events were the second major grouping of pedestrian crash types and accounted for 26.5% of all pedestrian crashes, and that's from the Transportation Research Board. Among this group, the most common crash type, one-third of all, was the mid-block dash, where a pedestrian would run into the street and the motorist's view was not obstructed. While it's unlikely that pedestrians will cross only at intersections, it is possible to help them cross roads in between intersections in a more visible and safe manner through the use of mid-block crosswalks. Installation of mid-block crosswalks acknowledges that pedestrians prefer to travel to their destination using the shortest route possible. A mid-block crossing creates a safer, more visible, and more direct route without requiring the pedestrian to walk to the nearest intersection or cross at a random and sometimes, excuse me, dangerous location. I have a copy for you if you like. So that's basically what our request is. As I say, I'm representing the community association as well as myself, and I hope you'll consider it. Again, I don't think there's anything inherently, I could be wrong, I'm not a traffic engineer, but nothing inherently dangerous about a mid-block as long as the criteria is met for visibility.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions for Mr. Mesko? Are there any other residents who'd like to speak to this time? I haven't heard from folks before.
Hello. My name is Roberta Pato. I live in Port also. I just wanted to say that in the wintertime, it is almost impossible to get across that street, Hampton Avenue, because the snow is piled up, and if you have to cross the street, you have to walk either to the driveway, then walk from the driveway all the way around to where the parking garage is to be able to get on. You have to walk in the street. Otherwise, it's impossible to get around without going all the way back to Pleasant Street. And it causes a real problem. And I know that it is extremely dangerous to walk in the street, not to mention the fact that you get sprayed every time you walk and a car passes you by. So I think that a crosswalk is extremely important for safety and for people who are in wheelchairs, because they really have an issue of being able to cross the street at all without going all the way to Pleasant Street. So I respectfully request a crosswalk there.
I appreciate that. And just a follow-up, if you go to Pleasant Street and you cross at that location,
do you
not cross to the other side and use that sidewalk?
What that sidewalk looks like over there?
Oh, I know, it's a mess. Yeah, no.
It's impossible over there. It's a mess. So I think that's even unfeasible for anybody in a wheelchair to do even, because if they go over in front of WHMP, they'll kill themselves, just about. Anyhow, thank you.
Well, I appreciate it. Thank you very much. Are there other residents?
Hi. My name is Robert Danilico. I'm from 20 Hampton Avenue, Court of Presidents.
and echo pretty much the same as what everybody has said about crosswalk. And I take the common route too, going from downtown and into Side Street and coming back home to Hampton Court, and I take the same way in Crossing Street, so I know what that's like. And I agree and stand by it that it would be a better, I think, clear access point. And as far as the snowbanks on the side are concerned, that would actually be a benefit to clearing that stuff out too, and having more of an access point for people around that area and people who live in the complex itself. And I guess that's all I have to say.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Allen. Thank you. Appreciate that. Any other comments? Ward 4, Councilor. Jamie Lee Sharon.
Everybody, Julian Shara, 145 State Street, Ward 4, City Councilor. I've talked to you all about this before, but just to reiterate, I mean, I think my biggest concern are the people in wheelchairs, and there are quite a few that live there. As you were just hearing, those going down the Pleasant Street is really hard. Those curb cuts are pretty rocky there, too. And the sidewalk between Pleasant and sort of the end past the HMP parking lot is a mess. It's also kind of a little bit hard to navigate. There's a fire hydrant and signs, and some of the residents have sort of larger wheelchairs. And I think that's a particularly tough spot for them to get down. You know, obviously I share concerns about safety, and I recognize that as people turn from Pleasant Street, they could, if you know, if they don't anticipate someone's going to be there, that could be dangerous. But people do cross there all the time. I mean, I was looking at Google Maps today, and like there, you see people crossing like on the street, you know, on Google Maps. And sometimes crosswalks do kind of give a false sense of security to people. So you know, if there's a way that we could do this so that all those factors are taken into account, and there's really good signage, and just find a way to make this a safer crossing for people that also alerts cars that it's, that there is a crossing, I think it would be really good and very beneficial in this community.
Thank you very much. Was anyone else who'd like to comment on this? Okay. Well, thank you. Being aware of the time, I think this is our favorite subject so far in the last 3 minutes. We've discussed it a lot. We've heard a lot about it, at least. And the first thing I would say is I'm reaching for the signature page, but it's traveled away. I appreciate all the advocacy of the residents, and it's great to see so many signatures and support for this. What I'd like to say is that while public support is a necessary condition, it's not a sufficient condition. And so the conversation I would like to have if we talk about this is in fact about the safety issues related to mid-block crosswalks in general and a mid-block crosswalk at this location, because as far as I'm concerned, the whole city could be in favor of it, and if it were dangerous, I would not support it. So I'm sure we can all agree, whether a resident there or a member of the commission, that there's no way we're going to install a crosswalk that's dangerous. That's the test in my mind. I'm not sure we have a written policy describing how we make that decision. I looked it up. Some states do. Some states have rules, for example, the number of feet from the nearest other crosswalk. If this were Virginia, we'd not be able to establish it because they require 300 feet. And this is more like 200. So lacking that, or maybe there are rules that we have that I'm not aware of, but I would like to have a discussion in those terms, acknowledging the very strong support of the community, and again, honestly thanking them for it. But the role of this commission, I think, is to be the devil's advocate, be very cautious and careful about what we do in terms of pedestrian safety. So I think that is really the only thing I have to say to frame this debate. But I look around the commission and see lots of experts who have, I think, valuable experience and knowledge that would benefit this question. So with that, I don't know if there's any members of the commission who'd like to comment on it.
Sure. My biggest concern with mid-block crossings is the fact that drivers usually are expecting it to stay to happen. Usually they're looking for the next intersection, cars coming in and out, and so on. So city doesn't have a policy. We have installed them, like Meadow Street, Florence Fields, that's a mid-block crossing. We have done them in the past, but you know, you want to make sure you have good sight distances and stopping distances in advance of it. and it's an extremely safe area, but drivers don't expect things to happen mid-block like that. That's why we kind of frown around.
Well, as I look at the map, it seems to me that the, I call it the entrance-exit route to the parking garage, that feels more like a block to me. So I think having a crosswalk there would feel like an intersection. So my guess is that, and I'm guessing because I don't know this, but a mid-block crosswalk would apply to me, there's no turn. And turning movements would slow speeds in motor vehicles. So I think that's in part why you'd have crosswalks there. It's also a route. So in this case, in fact, I heard somebody say getting access from the apartments to the parking garage, it would seem to me that a true mid-block crosswalk would be the one that's closest to the middle, and also where you probably have a higher turning movements, I would guess, if you would actually do a traffic study to measure turning movements, that the entrance and exit to the parking garage might make sense to me.
Thoughts from a planning perspective, maybe?
Well, I sort of agree. I mean, I think you can make, I agree the danger of mid-block is the lack of expectation. To some extent, either one, because there's more turning movements, you can make an argument for either. Their preferred location feels like less of a mid-block crosswalk than most places because there's a lot of volume there. But I agree there's probably a lot more volume going to the parking garage than there is going there. But it's less of an issue to me than some places we talked about, where there's the reality is, because either case, there's only a turn in one direction. I think we have to be really careful about advanced warning systems anyway, whether that's a speed hump or whether that's advanced warning signage. Because it still feels, I mean, frankly, that's the shortcut I take, and I know I drive faster than the avenue than I should, because it doesn't really feel like you're going through an intersection right there, so it's simply careful about that.
And I think this actually echoes what residents have said when they brought up signage, and you know, the way you install this crosswalk is pretty important. You don't, let's say we went forward with it, you wouldn't want to just throw paint down on the ground and be satisfied. You might still be a little nervous about that.
Those low flashing lights that they use in Erston, I mean, there are other things that allow you to go across, but the expense comes up considerably.
You know, raised crosswalk is
just one of them.
Obviously,
there are lights as well. Well, you know, that when you push the button, the lights go, but back and forth all the time, I'm not sure how that would work.
My other question, I mean, there's also the illumination at this location, I think is very important. I don't know what that is. Maybe the residents can tell us. Obviously, there has to be adequate illumination. I would be interested in, I mean, you know, when you're doing a mid-block crosswalk, what I'm hearing is that you're taking the desire lines that people normally follow and you're trying to collect them into a more sensible and less random place to cross. Is that really at this location? We don't have data on it. I don't know if we need data. I don't know if it's possible to collect data. But there's that. What is the average speed of a car on Hampton Avenue? I mean, if cars are, I don't know. If cars are going 40 miles an hour, that's different than if they're going 30 miles an hour, I would think, for a mid-block crosswalk. I'm not trying to throw cold water. It sounds like I am. Actually, you know, maybe I am in a sense, because again, I do think it's our role to play devil's advocate here, and that's what I'm trying to do, and I hope people understand that. So there's the lack of data that's flagging as well.
But at least I'm hearing there's a consensus that there should be a crosswalk in one of the two spots. It's really like which one is safer. Is that a fair summary?
I don't know. I mean, I think certainly from the residents' point of view, that's absolutely. Councilor?
I guess I would just like to add in that, you know, if we seriously consider putting in a mid-block crosswalk, we really do have to take into consideration that it is a crosswalk that's going to be used by people, a number of people, a large number of people with disabilities, people in wheelchairs. There's a real safety factor there just because people in wheelchairs are going to be lower. So the sight line for drivers is going to be a little bit harder. And I think that if we're going to do this responsibly, we would have to do it with particular kinds of safety measures that a regular crosswalk might not have. So I just think that that's really important for us to keep in mind.
That's a great point.
I think that I would sort of frame that a little bit differently. I would say we have to do it at least as well as we would do any new crosswalk. So I think probably signage on both sides, showing, making sure that really well signed, well painted, that we had detectable warning surfaces, ramps, all that stuff being done appropriately. Going above and beyond that, I don't know about that. But I do wonder about first cost maintenance, setting up an expectation that the snow will be cleared in a reasonable amount of time, which is not easy to do everywhere. I don't know what happens downtown, but I know that's not the city, right? The owners have the responsibility. So I think all those expectations need to be really clear, too.
Any other comments from commission members? Ms. Lomowski, you wanted to add something?
Yeah, I just want to address a couple of those. First of all, the Kirkland isn't a mid-block. That's a street. That's a city street. All the issues about mid-block really don't apply to that. That's just a T intersection. But I have to say that the other street, which is not officially a street, which is a driveway to Armory, is used as a street. And I would welcome traffic counts. And actually, we had asked for, when was the last time there was a traffic count in Hampton? And all that, analytical data would be very helpful and useful. And I applaud the planning department for getting the money to do this and the study, and really looking forward to what the consultants are going to say about this. In terms of access, that's one of the issues we have, and the ramps have to be shoveled by property owners. So I believe the management company from our building sent a letter of support, and they assured us that ramp would have access, and they do that now because they're responsible for Pleasant Street. And then I also approached the general manager, HMP, who was also in favor. I don't know if he sent me anything, but it was kind of late. But he assured me that they would welcome it, and that they would. And I said, well, you're going to have to maintain this. And they said, yes, that was good. I also applaud you, Mr. Chairman, and the commission, that safety is the most important factor. But fact of the matter is it going to be more safe to have a crosswalk there or not? That's the issue. Right now, there's no crosswalk, and in terms of people who are disabled, and I think you were there with one of the residents, and the chief of police was there with one of the residents, and they show you where they go. I mean, Dominique goes down to a spot that's just a gap in the curb. So, and yes, they could go to Pleasant Street, but it's just unrealistic. People cross pretty much right at the spot we're talking about. Personally, I'd welcome either spots. I would go to the other one. I do it now just as a way to get used to it. But I think most people are still going to cross where we're proposing it. So you're fighting human nature. But, I welcome any more information. And it sounds like the upcoming study is going to be very useful for that. Thanks.
Thank you. Councilman.
I was just going to suggest that if maybe, decisions not going to be made and further reflection is needed, that maybe the Disability Commission might be a place to turn to for suggestions on how to handle a crosswalk where multiple people with disabilities will be.
That's a good idea.
That's my
idea. Well, we do have, it's 15 minutes until 6, and I'm not sure we will reach a decision on this. I guess my question is, how do we want to leave this item for this meeting? I think it's very, I don't want to lose track of it. I think it has a lot of people who are saying it would benefit them, and so I think it's our responsibility to take a serious look at it. But for next steps, I'm not sure what would be best. When are we planning on having data from this crosswalk study?
So the overall project needs to be done by the middle of September. There may be intermediate phases, but
Well, I hate to leave it just dangling for this meeting, but I think we're going to have to return to it with a specific proposal one way or the other. I don't just want to approve, first of all, it should be said that this is an advisory body. If you don't know, we're purely an advisory body. We can't require that a crosswalk be painted anywhere. But insofar as we're making a recommendation, I think that we can't just recommend a crosswalk. We should recommend a certain kind of crosswalk with certain features. And I would like to do it based on as much data as possible. I don't know if it's appropriate to pull up. We may have accident data for this, for Hampton Avenue. I don't know if we have speed data or traffic going.
I don't think we have anything on that, much of anything.
Well, I guess I would just suggest that if we return to this at our next meeting, that we have a discussion to the extent we can outside of the meeting, which is not very much, but and possibly bring these specific things to that discussion so we can have a more informed discussion.
Can we request at this meeting that the commission ask the DPW to do a traffic study?
Are you making that request?
I'd like to make a motion that we suggest that the Department of Public Works that we do a traffic study on Hampton Avenue.
Okay, so
that's a motion. And potentially look at turning movements off of Kirkland and across the parking lot.
Okay, so the exact motion is that we're requesting the DPW to do a general traffic study of Hampton Avenue, including volume and speed.
And if possible, turn movements.
Turn
may be observational for the time.
Okay.
Not just separate times.
Okay. And so Mr. Harwood makes a motion, Councilor Klein seconds it. Is there any discussion on the motion to make the recognition? Director Hadley.
I would rather look at stopping sight distances on the road at the posted speed limit. I'm sure the road's posted down there. 25, 30 miles an hour?
Not sure.
And that's going to be a key to what you, if you do want to do a mid-block crossing, it's going to be a key that a driver has enough time to stop when he comes around the corner or that sight distance that he needs.
What is it, 10 times the speed, posted speed limit or something like that?
There's a formula, basically, you're looking at an object 6 inches in height off the ground, and you're like 3.5 feet off the ground, speed limit of it, and whether or not you actually have time to react and stop in time. So that'd be an easy look to start to see whether or not it's a safe area to even look at a mid-block crossing versus Meadow Street. I mean, you can see long distances on a Meadow Street. So that might be something that might be a little bit easier besides, and I'm not trying to say that we won't do traffic down, but pedestrian counts or turning movement counts are a little bit different also. Yeah. And it'd take a little more time and staff to do that.
Okay. Well, there's a motion for doing a study still on the floor. Is anyone want to speak to that motion?
We also have a lot of traffic counseling that we're missing out, so it's like a backlog we have right now. I'm not sure if we can get to that.
Okay.
The motion didn't contain the word quickly.
We don't like that word in this committee. Slow, deliberate.
Can we amend the motion to include something along the lines of what Director Huntley is suggesting be done?
Sure.
Well, so to me, that would be part of the traffic study. You put out the counter study, also.
Right, but those stopping sight distances are going to tell you right up front whether or not the driver has adequate time to stop
right
at the posted speed limit.
Right, but wouldn't it help us inform, like if we had a traffic study of Hampton Avenue and we also then looked at stopping distances, that would tell us what the volumes are, what the speeds are, and whether or not it's appropriate to have a crosswalk here, or if this would be better. It's just more data.
Director Huntley's point, if I'm not mistaken, is that if the sight distances are not there, we don't even need to do a traffic study because the DPW would oppose it. Is that correct?
Well,
I'm just trying to interpret what I'm hearing.
I don't know what you meant exactly, but it seems like people are going to cross no matter what. So we probably ought to have an idea of volume and speed.
Okay.
And then maybe it's really more of a traffic calming thing that we got to look at.
Okay.
That's true. It doesn't address people crossing in wintertime, snow, accessibility, et cetera.
So is there a need for us to make some kind of motion that asks requests to stop? What is it, stopping sight line?
Stopping sight distances. I mean, it's a calculation that you can do. You can look at that in advance without doing any work of data collection. It's a calculation of distances is what it is, and at speeds.
So is just this discussion enough to trigger you doing that, or do we need to make a motion and have that as a formal?
We have a motion on the floor to do a full traffic, or to request a full traffic study. So we can, you know, if you want, you can withdraw the motion, we can have a full vote on it.
Can it be contingent upon the first piece of information that comes in?
Okay, how would you describe the contingency?
Well, the impression I got was if certain considerations are there, there's no point in going any further. Or if you're going further, you have to look at what it is you're going to do that goes further. Rather than...
So you're looking at road geometry is really what they're looking at. They're looking at vertical and horizontal geometry. You know, there's a curve there down by the apartments or the buildings there. That might not be an ideal place, but if you put it up on the straightaway, where, you know, you're traveling 25 miles an hour and the engineering calculation that it's going to take, you know, 225 feet to stop a car for a normal driver. And if you have 200 feet, that's surely not enough. We do this with subdivision roadways. Coming into other streets. This is one of the reasons why the bridge development took so long to be developed, because they had to wait for Route 66 to be built, because the original proposal, it couldn't meet horizontal geometry with stopping site distances.
As a practical matter, to Ms. Chan's point, are you going to be able to do this study this year?
Probably not.
Okay. Well, we can always make the request, and if it's not done, then it's not done, and we can always rescind the request as well if you determine certain things about the stopping distance.
I'd rather do that first so that,
okay.
I mean, they're fairly straightforward okay. calculations based on road geometry.
Okay, so the request is that this motion be withdrawn, is what I'm hearing, so the Director Huntley can do this calculation and bring it to the next meeting?
Sure.
But it doesn't have to be, because it's on the floor, so it's up to the makers of the motion. And if someone wants to call a question, we just vote on it anyways. So, no pressure.
I'm happy to wait.
Okay.
I know it's not going to happen this winter, I mean, before winter. I mean, the road geometry tank could, but I know the traffic study can't happen. There's plenty of other things to do.
Just to stir the pot a little bit.
Please,
but by all means. After Ned does, the DPW does the initial assessment with the observations, since we are going to move into winter, does it make sense to do any observational analysis with snow on the ground this winter and fold that into whatever studies we end up doing in the spring? Since we're going to be given more than enough snow in about a month.
We don't know that. To me, that certainly makes sense.
Is there anything, Ned, that you could look at, you know, as we start to have snow buildup on the road as far as your observation analysis?
The only thing you can do observation analysis, but, you know, the other thing too is that you're also not going to have, once you have snow banks on the side of the road, you're probably not going to have pedestrians crossing at any place they want to. They're going to wait for different openings and so on. So once the snow and the snow piles on the street, that probably might change things a little bit.
Yeah.
To the motion, we can vote on it, we can withdraw it, we can make it again in December. So, what's the options?
I would be happy to withdraw it as well.
I'm happy with that, yeah.
Okay. Good. Thank you. And then the understanding is that Department of Public Works will bring this calculation, some basic information to our next meeting about stopping. And that's how we'll proceed, if that's okay with the residents.
I really want to answer.
All I can say is if safety is your concern, I would really seriously look at this and expedite it as much as possible before something happens. I mean, people in the winter, you're right, they don't cross mid, you know, where we're proposing it, but they do go to the driveways and go up the street, which is even worse. I welcome anybody to make a site visit. We'd be glad to
to, you know, to attend. Any other commission members who would like to do that?
Yeah, thanks. I encourage that also. But yeah, again, I think I understand the need, you know, that you want to get this done. From my perspective, I think from the perspective of others, I mean, we have to do it in a deliberative fashion. So.
Isn't there a speed limit, a blanket without being posted in a downtown street? Can't we just?
It's called prima facie, is what it's called. It's part of the state speed regulations. And it has to do with density of population and a certain distance of roadway. I would say offhand, probably Hampton is probably a 25 mile an hour street.
Okay.
Under prima facie. If it's posted, that's a different story. It goes to the posted limit.
Okay. Yeah, I'd be comfortable with you just doing the analysis and bringing it to the next meeting. Okay. Thank you very much. Is there any objection to continuing items 5, 6, 7, and 8 to the next meeting? Without objection, those are continued to the next meeting. However, item 9 is one I would like to do briefly. Memorandum from the mayor. He writes, pursuant to the Northampton Code of Ordinances, section 312.36N, I am respectfully requesting that the Transportation and Parking Commission approve the suspension of parking fees in all off-street parking lots on December 31st, 2015, in support of Northampton First Night.
So moved.
Director Klein moves approval. Councilor Klein seconds. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, thank you very much. Any new business? Is there a motion to adjourn? Okay. Councilor Klein makes the motion. Ms. Brooks seconds. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.